Hi, Nick. Thank you for coming. What's the difference between bacterial and complex life?
Well, it's just a matter of degree. Bacteria are simple as you see them under the microscope, even an electron microscope. In terms of the molecules, though, they're enormously complex. So they are complex, difficult cells, difficult to explain in themselves. But then if you compare them with what we call a complex eukaryotic cell, a cell with a nucleus, like one of our own cells, they're on average, tens, if not hundreds of thousands of times larger and full of complicated machinery that you don't really see in bacteria. So it's a matter of degree.
Is there something about the distinction between the two that means it's unlikely that there is life elsewhere in the universe?
Potentially so. It depends on two things, really. Number one is, can you extrapolate from what happened here to anywhere else in the universe? And of course, we don't know the answer, but we can try and structure the question in a way which makes it potential as an argument, at least. So the question is, are there constraints on bacteria that stop them becoming large and complex? And are those constraints something you would expect to see in life anywhere else? And I would answer, yes, there are constraints in the relates mechanism. And then the question is, well, how easy is it to break those constraints? And I would argue that the answer is not so easy. It only happened here once in 4 billion years on Earth. And I would not expect it to be so different anywhere else. So that doesn't mean we won't see complex life elsewhere. It just means that there isn't an inevitability, a driving force that starts with life, that the universe is seeded with life, and somehow we will end up with complex, sentient, human-like creatures as the inevitable entry point. I don't think that's true.
And from a probabilistic argument, if we presume that the universe is infinite, is it not a certainty then that complex life does or will exist somewhere else?
That may be true. I mean, the universe is probably not infinite, but even if it's infinite and even if there is life elsewhere, then there's also the practical difficulty of how far away is it and what are the chances of us ever meeting it, which would be then very good.
So how was the evolution and the origin of life on Earth constrained by the provision of energy?
Well, the way that energy actually works in cells is quite bizarre. It's not how anyone imagines. So I guess that most people will think of a cell as a kind of bag with stuff in it. And the way that these bags actually work is all the real activity goes across the surface of the bag. That's how energy works. We effectively have an electric bag. And the stuff inside is less important than the surface of the bag, which is electric bag.
And that's how all cells work. Every cell that we know about on Earth works that way. It's got an electric surface. Why? It probably goes back to how life started. It's so universal, it's so fundamental, so important. It probably, that kind of structure probably arose in hydrothermal vents where we see similar structure, topological structure. And that's why I think life might have started in vents and why I think that kind of constraint of energy across the cell membrane, an electrified membrane, is a serious constraint on what cells can do.
Are humans still evolving?
Probably, not necessarily. We're not necessarily getting a larger brain, but we're probably getting better at living in cities, in high urban densities, things like that. I mean, evolution works in many, many different ways. So yes, of course, we're changing. We may not be changing for the better. We may not be changing visibly, but I'm sure we're changing. It's just a matter of technically changes in gene frequency. What kind of genes do better in the modern environment compared to a previous environment? And that has to change every generation.
So evolution works in different ways, biological, your physical differences, psychological, which is related to biology, of course, too. But does it operate in different ways? Is there an analogy to be drawn between the development of cultures and society to evolution?
I think there is an analogy. I think we shouldn't push it too far. And I think cultural evolution, yes, there are some similarities, and yes, there's something in memes, for example, but I wouldn't personally try and deconstruct human society along those lines. It's enormously richer and more complex than that. If we were to say, is there any biological basis underpinning it? Of course, yes, there is, but it's fairly deeply buried, I would say, and most of what most people are interested in culture is purely cultural.
Potentially a difficult one in its scope. What does it mean to be alive?
What does it mean to me, or what does it mean to life itself to be alive?
Both.
Yes. Well, to be alive I suppose, is the opposite of being dormant or dead, or simply not existing. So if you were to take a seed, for example, is it alive? Well, it's a life form, but it's not living at the moment, it's dormant. And so in that sense, whether something's alive or not depends on whether it's moving, interacting with its environment, whether it's effectively burning energy. And so to be alive means a complex informational system which is driven by constant energy flow.
What would life on Earth look like now if Homo sapiens had never evolved?
I imagine it would look rather like the rainforest, the unspoiled rainforest still does, which is to say it would be enormously richer than it actually is, which is a tremendous shame. If we just wheel back the clock, you know, a few million years, life on Earth would have been equally, if not more, flamboyant than it is already, but there would have been nothing here capable of spacefaring travel, of communication across long distances. I mean, I think from an intellectual point of view, the planet would be almost meaningless. If we were to discover a planet as rich as the Earth somewhere else, we would be thrilled. But if we then found that the highest form of intelligence on it was the level of an octopus, we might be disappointed. But that's actually what we would probably find. If we were to find complex life at all, chances of finding something as intelligent as humans is fairly slight.
So how were humans able to evolve to the point where they had the capabilities to do all these things that an octopus wouldn't be able to do?
I can't really answer that. That's not what I work on. A lot seems to be to do with the flukes of history, with changing environments, with having hands that are capable with opposing thumbs, of wielding tools, of having social groups. There's all kinds of reasons why humans went this way. What was the selective driver for large brains? Perhaps controlling fire might have been part of it. Perhaps that's impossible if you're an octopus. Why aren't there terrestrial octopuses? You know, there's lots of paths that evolution could have gone down and didn't go down. So I can't really answer the question, but I would say a series of physical parameters plus social evolution, and social evolution probably more important than anything else.
What's the future of life on Earth?
I really sincerely hope that it contains humans, let's put it that way. I mean, I think we are in serious danger of obliterating life as we know it on Earth. Now, for the planet, that's really not a problem, because we're not going to kill everything. I doubt that we have the power to kill everything. There'll be plenty of bacteria still out there, plenty of single-celled eukaryotes, and probably plenty of insects and things. And give 5 or 10 million years and life will be back to where it was. It wouldn't surprise me very much. We will have just wiped ourselves out. So I don't think that we're in serious danger of wiping out life on Earth, but I think we're in serious danger of wiping out the Earth as we know it and as we love it and as we care about it. And we're in serious danger of doing it pretty soon, and we've really got to stop.
I've asked you before the difficult question of what does it mean to be alive. Would that conception be changed by finding other organisms as complex as us, say extraterrestrials?
That's a very interesting question. It's part of the debate this afternoon, and I would have a conservative answer to that, which I think is all that science can do. So there's two aspects to science. There's the rational, logical side, which tries to build on what we know already, and then there's an exploratory side, which just goes out and looks. And they're both necessary sides to science. And there's an aspect of, let's explore the universe, let's look what's out there, and let's be ready to be surprised. And there's another side which says, well, let's try and understand life on Earth, and let's try and understand what are the constraints and the principles that govern life on Earth. If we can understand why life arose on this planet, what course it took, and why it ended up here, then we can look around the universe and say, well, what should we be looking for out there? Would it be like us, or would it be radically different? My view is it would be surprisingly like us, not us as human beings, but us as carbon-based organisms with energy burning across the cell membrane and these kind of deep fundamental constraints that force life down particular pathways.
What questions are you yourself and evolutionary biochemistry as a whole trying to answer?
I suppose I am trying to understand where we came from and why. I'm trying to understand how a sterile planet can give rise to life at all, why it is that complex life apparently only arose once on Earth, why is it so rare, apparently more difficult than the origin of life itself. Why does complex life have so many weird properties that we don't see at all in bacteria and which we share with plants and we share with fungi and algae and amoeba? And ultimately, I suppose, what does this long evolutionary history say about ourselves, our own health, our consciousness, our ability to form a society? So it's very distant, the origin of life, but it lays down a set of principles and a way of thinking about the questions that I don't doubt impact on us in the end, and I would like to know how.
And do you expect any answers to the specific questions within that to come soon?
I expect that some of the answers will come soon. I think that we'll probably keep arguing about them for a long time. And I think the trouble with answers is they're very rarely simple and only open to one interpretation. Knowledge is fractal. It becomes ever more complex and difficult to understand. I think what I'm looking for is my own personal understanding that I can convey to others who are interested. And I think we're on the point of understanding some very important things about the history and the origin and the evolution of life. I think within my lifetime, there's a good chance that we will understand an awful lot more than we do now. And I hope to be part of that.
How does spirituality and religion as a structure intersect with your field?
It doesn't. There are some very good evolutionary biologists who are religious. I don't think there's any particular requirement that you must be an atheist if you're a scientist. I don't think that holds. But I think science as a method keeps religion out of it. So there's lots of things that could have happened. So life, you know, perhaps God did start the universe. Perhaps God did start life. I cannot, as a scientist, say that didn't happen. But it's a very unproductive question. If he did, if that's my view, and I say, okay, God did it, then now what do? I go down the pub and have a pint, I guess, and do something else with my life. If I say, on the contrary, let's assume that God didn't do it, let's assume that there are naturalistic processes. From my point of view, we can admit perhaps God put those naturalistic processes in being, but what are the naturalistic processes? Then we can ask questions. The assumption that underpins it might be wrong, but we can ask questions, we can do experiments, and in the end, we can justify whether or not that assumption underpinning it was right or wrong. And I think most evolutionary biologists would agree that there is no requirement for God to explain the origin and trajectory of life on Earth. We can't prove that, but there's no requirement for it.
What developments are you particularly excited about in your field?
There's always discoveries happening. In the last few years, there have been discoveries of a particular group, obscure group of archaea, which seem to be linked with the origins of eukaryotic cells. It's a very eclectic thing to be excited about. Recently, though, just a month or two ago, it turns out that they don't have the size and shape we might have imagined for them. They have long kind of tentacles, and they engulf other cells that way. So it may be that this begins to rewrite some of the way that we think about the origins of complexity. So in one sense, it's very abstruse. In another sense, it's very meaningful. But these are cells that exist today. We're trying to infer from something that exists today something that might have happened 2 billion years ago. And so it's open to multiple interpretations and possibilities. We just know more about the world now than we did before. So most of the things that I find very exciting are too abstruse to really talk about to get people excited unless I put it as part of a lecture and try and give some context around just why it's exciting.
How important is it to communicate complicated ideas to a general audience?
I think really important. I mean, for two reasons. One of them is purely personal, which is to say, it's the only way I can understand it myself. If I try and put it into plain words, then I can see where I don't understand it myself. And it may seem strange, but if you stick with the scientific terminology, you tend to write complex sentences and think in a complex way, and then you don't see the simple things that are missing. And so trying to write for the public or communicate with the public also forces me to hold a mirror up to myself and say, hang on, you don't understand that yourself, or that, and so, you know, it keeps you grounded, and it forces you to see where the real questions are. And the other reason is that the world's in a very dangerous place, and I value rationality, and if we as scientists can't communicate and explain why it's important and why it's exciting and why a scientific worldview is not some dusty, dull textbook rationalism, but an exciting adventure and exploration and the thing which has driven humanity forwards more than anything else, then I think we're failing in our job as scientists. I think it's really important to capture the flavor of why science is exciting and rational and why it can improve humanity and society. Because I think without science, we would still be in the dark ages. We would be in a place that nobody would want to live in. And we're in danger of throwing too much of that out by reacting against experts, by thinking that experts are in some way a fount of wisdom, when in fact all they do is think about things and have some more subtle, gradated thoughts. They may be wrong, but I think we need to kind of re-engage in some way. And there's a disturbing lack of sympathy between too much of the public and too many scientists, and somehow we've got to bridge that gap again. And that's another reason why I think it's really important to try and communicate.
Are you worried that political agents selectively edit or completely ignore science to their whim?
I think it's regrettable that not so many scientists go into politics, and it would be good if more did. And as soon as I say that kind of thing, then I have to turn it back on myself and say, so why don't I do that then? And I don't really want to. Maybe I'm doing what I do best, which is to say, attempt to communicate, attempt to get things across, attempt to explain why science is exciting and why we should be rational. And in some sense, that's political. I doubt I would be a particularly good politician, but I think we need to have more scientists, more people trained in science and thinking like scientists and understanding what science can and cannot tell us in politics. And I guess most people are realizing that politics is important. Even the more we despise politicians, the more we appreciate that politics is really important. And it seems to me a lot of politicians are doing their best in difficult circumstances, but somehow we've got to defend society as it stands better than we have done.
So no plans to enter the Commons in the future.
Not for me.
But what are your plans? What is the future of Nick Lane?
I can't think more than a couple of years in advance, and even that's difficult. I have a book that I'm writing at the moment. I have research, which is funded for another year or two, and after that won't be. And so I would like to know some answers to some of the questions I'm asking. I would like to try and communicate it. I would like to try and keep that going as long as possible. And I would like to give back down the line. I'm in a university. It's a privileged place to be. I would like to defend what universities do and stand for and help students bring on a younger generation, open the doors to a wider cross-section of younger generations. Many things I would like to give back within a university context. In a broader political context, I haven't thought about that.
Finally, are there other academic areas, perhaps outside of STEM entirely, that you would like your research and your work to influence?
Yes, because I suppose my research and my work is very much science, and I don't really try and step outside science to society or try and put it in a societal context. But I am trying to get through to non-scientists, and I regret if I could only get through to scientists. I don't want to preach to the converted. I want to get through to other people. Not by changing the discipline, but by making science less forbidding, by making it more exciting, by bringing some of the reality that science is a creative human endeavor, that it's not a kind of stale and dry, that there's a lot in common with art, there's a lot in common with history, with social sciences generally. I think there's a tendency to split the world into arts and sciences, and to me they're soulmates in some way, and I would like to get that across.
What a lovely thought to end on. Thank you very much, Nick Lane.
Pleasure, thank you.
For more debates, talks and interviews, subscribe today to the Institute of Art and Ideas at IAI TV.